Okay, so for our next session, we're going to talk about Relevance Decoded, How Purpose Reignites Growth for Heritage Brands. This is produced in partnership with Lippy Taylor and 12 Note. Thank you for their partnership on that. To lead the session, please welcome to the stage Denise Vitola, who's VP Brand Integration PR, Social and Influencer for Consumer Health at Bayer, and Tracy Naden, who's the president of Lippy Taylor. Please welcome them to the stage.
Okay. I think I'm going to stand.
Sounds good.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
I can't see anything.
Just one sec.
Okay. Okay.
Good to go.
It's working.
Awesome.
Good news, everyone.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for the great introduction. We're really excited to be here. We thought we'd kick off with our premise right out of the gate. So heritage brands have been in decline around the Fortune 500 for a very long time. And what we're here to talk to you about today is brand purpose and how we think this is one of the most effective shortcuts to reinvigorating heritage brands today.
Keep going.
There we go.
All right. So we're going to jump into an example. But before we do, some of you may recognize that product on the screen. It is a heritage brand. And quite honestly, a brand that had been forgotten and really wasn't resonating with younger consumers. And we had a problem. We were on the bottom shelves of all retailers, and no one was really considering us. So we had a lot of work to do. And you know, we felt that in driving and bringing in purpose and a purpose platform, that would truly make a difference. So I'll get into more later on why and how that worked, but I'll just reveal. Give you a little bit of a spoiler. It worked. It worked tremendously well. And we had an embarrassment of fortunes. And we've had tons of awards for this program. So hopefully when you watch it, you'll agree that it is an award-winning program. But most importantly, it actually grew the business. And it connected with our consumers in a big way. So we're going to roll this video for you. And hopefully this. Okay, how did we do that, Tracy?
So we're really excited that the MITL mission work is continuing, and we're so proud of this, and can dig in a little bit more and take a step back into how we got there. So, you know, in addition to heritage brands being in decline, they still offer us a ton of inherent value. They are proven, they have really good quality, they fulfill a very strong consumer need. But there also is a nostalgia factor. So we've got Stranger Things up here. I was in an Urban Outfitters over the weekend with my daughter, and every single 80s trend that I lived through was there. And I found myself so excited and fun. I was buying banana clips. There were leg warmers there. I don't know if any of you remember them, but it was hilarious. And I spent more money on this stuff that I didn't need. But that's what you tend to do when you have these feelings of nostalgia. So heritage brands lean into this as well, but there are so many other assets that they have going for them too. And what they really have in common is scale. They have scale in marketing investment, they have scale in retail distribution, and they have scale in pre-existing awareness. However, even with all of that scale, why are they still so in decline? So even before the pandemic, 90 of the top 100 brands in grocery stores were losing market share. And in January 2020, top brands were down 2.8% overall in points of retail distribution over the prior year. And this one, I think, was quite astounding. $17 billion of annual packaged food sales, which is 3.5% of the market, has shifted from incumbent brands to startup brands. And even though those statistics in particular were from prepackaged foods in grocery stores, this is happening across every industry possible. So whether it's automotive or beauty or entertainment, you name it, there are the same trends happening across the board. And the challenger brands you see here that are challenging this market share really have two main things in common. One, they're purpose-driven brands. Or two, they're digitally born brands that have had purpose built into them very early on in their existence. So this really calls into question everything we've thought about brand marketing over the last 20 to 30 years in terms of what consumers really value. And so there's a study by Havas that's widely cited that says 75% of brands could disappear overnight and most people wouldn't care or they would easily find a replacement. So again, we really need to kind of rethink all that we've learned about brand building throughout our careers. And when you think about it, even brands across all of those sectors that we mentioned, there really are a lot more in common than you think, and there's typically six key factors. So one, brick and mortar. They've over-relied on brick and mortar and points of sale. Marketers and communicators really kind of wrestle with whether or not you should lean into the heritage or if that makes you seem old or outdated. And your customer base is aging. Those loyal customers that you have never wanted to alienate are kind of growing out of the category a little bit and they're in a different life stage. And the younger consumers you want to reach are really gravitating towards more of those younger brands. And then from a media perspective, you've over-relied on traditional advertising. TV has still been a huge part of the marketing mix. And from an earn perspective, that credible earn that we all love and rely on is a little bit stale because you don't have that much new news to talk about. And then lastly, typically a lot of heritage brands have underinvested in their social channels. And typically they even may just be an iteration of their traditional advertising campaign.
Yeah, and Tracy, don't get me started about social media and heritage brands investing in social media. I have a presentation on that and a conversation for a whole nother day that I can say when I started out at Bayer, our consumer health brands were not on social media at all. Today, I'm proud to say that 99% of our brands are now on social media. So loud clap for that. But that's not for this presentation. But what I will say is Tracy just set it up where I would, if I saw all those facts, I'd say, you know, what am I doing? I need to quit my job. So there's not much for me to do. It's all doom and gloom. There's really nothing. So I'm going to pack my bag and move on. But there is opportunity. Where you see difficulty and challenges, there's always opportunity on the other side of that. So let's climb that hill together. When you look at something like this, it's like a brand equity tracker, brand health tracker. Lots of corporate communications teams are looking at these often. So for me, snooze, total snooze fest, because nothing really happens with a brand equity tracker unless something catastrophic happens. There's a major crisis, there's an acquisition, there's a major something goes on. So if you look at a brand here, this is Nike, a beloved brand. I would, you know, if I asked you all to raise your hands, but I'm not, of how many people love Nike, most of us do. So, you know, every year, year over year, this is 1 year versus 3 years, you see that Nike's getting a lot of love, and there's not much change there. But, you know, consequently, we can look at brand purpose trackers, and we do see a lot of movement. We see a lot of movement up and down when heritage brands and other brands are really leaning in and investing in purpose. Wow. So when you look at this chart, you see very familiar brands that are doing well. So we see Zoom, we see Pfizer. These brands came in and really helped us during the pandemic. And we relied on them in a major way. They were providing purpose to us. They were listening to what we were saying, and they were giving us what we needed. But does it always have to be a COVID-type situation for you to jump on and into purpose to make it right for your brand? Not necessarily. There's opportunities out there within the world that you can, attach yourself to, and take a look at some of the automotive brands here that are rising up. They're creating electric cars. They're listening to what consumers are saying, and they're listening to what we need in the world today. And that's driving their purpose, and they're driving their sentiment meter up. So I take a look at this, and what makes me excited, outside of some of the slides you shared that don't make me very excited, is that 16 out of 20 of these brands are billion-dollar companies. So that's good news, because I work for one of those companies. Not on this chart, but I do work for one of those companies. So we all love good stats, and why I show this is because we all talk about perception is reality, and we all deal with our executives or our leadership teams. And I found these stats to be quite interesting, because 87% of business leaders really believe that consumers feel that they're highly trusted. But then when you ask consumers, 30% of them trust brands. So there's this disparity there, and perception is not a reality in this current situation. But when you look at, 71% really don't believe that big brands deliver on their promises, and that's what I'm gonna get into to talk about a little bit. You know, when you talk about these smaller brands and the brands that Tracy highlighted, 76% of consumers actually do trust them. They believe in them, and they trust them more than large brands. And why is that? You know, it's because big brands are perceived as putting people over profit. They're trying to, you know, make their wallets fatter. They don't necessarily care about the people. They don't care about the environment. They're not trying to produce small batch. They're not doing locally grown. And these are not issues that are rising to the top at these larger companies and these heritage brands. So that's something, where this trust gap comes in. And, you know, you see movement in this trust gap when heritage brands do lean into purpose. So there's sensitivity when heritage brands execute purpose campaigns, because there's movement for the company. And when you do a, you know, sort of survey to test the sentiment, you see that consumers now are believing in your brand more and more.
So when we talk about messaging, we focus a lot on functional messaging and emotional messaging. And the study I mentioned before by Havas, it's called the Meaningful Brands Report, says that 39% of consumers are really motivated by functional messaging, while 32% are motivated by more of the personal messaging. And the challenge here for heritage brands is that private label is stealing share from the functional brands, and the small and digitally native brands are stealing share from the emotional side. So that's why I think we see all of those statistics in such a dire place. But what we also saw, we thought was really interesting and an opportunity for heritage brands, is this third category called the collective motivational category, where consumers are also motivated by brands that play a really large role and enable progress within society. So we're solving a societal problem, we're coming to the rescue to help correct social injustices. And we saw this during the pandemic, as Denise mentioned. You know, there's Pfizer, Clorox, all of those brands that really, you know, played an important role. But even before that, there are brands like Seventh Generation and Tom's that really were kind of at the forefront of this collective motivation category. And since then, a lot of heritage brands have really played catch up in a big way to regain some of their leadership by focusing on this collective motivation. And I think what this does is, we talked about scale and the negativity of brands being really big. Yeah. And this allows us to turn that into an advantage, because only a heritage brand can impact millions of people if you're taking on a purpose campaign. And this really does change perception among the eyes of the consumer.
And that's exactly one of those small brands. Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay, so I get the fun part where I get to, sorry, we're playing catch up here a little bit on these slides. Okay, so I get the fun part, I get to introduce all the videos, because I'm the client.
You pay for everything.
But I spent nearly 20 years on the agency side, so I've paid my dues. But this project in particular, when I was chatting with the team about it, and 12 Notes, our agency that has led all this work, I got goosebumps, and I was like, this is the shit. We have to do this. And, you know, it's those moments where you're kind of, and I'm even, like, tingling now. It's not because I'm nervous. I don't really get nervous. But it's because, like, knowing what this work did. And it is really a good example of how, again, One a Day is a very, very heritage brand. And we're a supplement that's in the sea of sameness, the vitamin category. And we tie this to a purpose. And I'm going to play it, and I'll talk about it in a little bit. I think you play it.
Increases sixfold, showing that we live in a time when people want to express the gratitude they feel more than ever. But while we may know how to express gratitude in words, we fall short on practicing with actions, especially towards ourselves. So One a Day multivitamin set out to change that by inspiring a movement to practice gratitude daily for everything our body does, big and small. We started by teaming up with Emmy Award winner Samira Wiley to co-produce The Gratitude Project, a documentary featuring inspirational stories from people who practice gratitude toward their bodies as a way to better themselves.
Gratitude is self-love in order to give back to others.
I love your body, and that's body gratitude, because you're embracing everything that you have as a blessing, your healthy body, an able body to get out.
Learning to practice gratitude has been one of the greatest lessons in this life.
Our film premiered at the 2022 Tribeca Festival. Samira, Christian, Tanya, and Casey's stories became a catalyst that inspired hundreds of others all across the country to come forward and share their own stories of body gratitude.
Hello. There's a long video that we have on the One a Day website that you'll have to take a look at, and it gets into the stories behind why we chose who we chose, and the team of people that came together with Samira on this project. It's really very moving, and that's the video or short documentary or movie, Dan would remind me, that we played at the Tribeca Festival. So when people see the MITOL program and they see the One a Day program, I often get asked, well, how did you do that? Like, how do you do that in a big organization? If you know me, you would know the answer to that. No, I'm just kidding. Anyway, inside joke.
No fear.
But really, you know, they're not asking me about, like, how did you cast that? How did you find the right agency? How did you, you know, execute this work? What everyone really wants to know is how we convince people within the organization to shift their investment to purpose. And that's really called alignment. Sorry, like I said, our slides are playing a little bit of catch up here. So it's confusing me of what you're seeing. But that's gaining alignment, right? So, you know, there's trust. So you have to gain trust from the people that are within your organization. And how do you do that? You do that by showing that purpose will drive profit. Purpose will grow the brand. And I'd love to stand up here and be so Pollyanna with everybody and tell you that, you know, we are doing it from the good of our heart. We are doing it from the good of our heart, but we are also here to sell product. So, you know, we can't get away from that. You know, that's who we are. That is in our DNA. But how do we take selling product and doing good within the world? And in order to do that, we have to convince brand managers and, you know, GMs and others within the organization that this is the right thing to do because it's really going to impact their business. So after you gain this alignment, it's important to really embed purpose with the brand team. Did I advance that slide?
No, you could just advance these one more.
You really got to integrate that in with the brand team. Because purpose needs to be in with the brand. It's got to be in everything. You can't have this like very cute comms idea and this little purpose campaign that you're doing, and that's working really well. The brand has to lean in completely because the customer, the consumer, will call us out on it because we're not really doing it well. We're not really investing in it. So then when we decide that we're really going to do this, we have to do it the right way. So you know, I believe and we believe that having this led by a comms agency is the right thing to do. We're the storytellers, we're the ones that know how to execute these types of things. Take some convincing within your organization. We have an integrated agency team, as most of your clients probably do. That gets a little muckety-muck and, you know, it's hard for us to rise to the top. You need somebody internally that's championing for your agency. And that's what we do because that's what works. When we've handed these types of things, sorry if anybody's worked at an advertising agency, but I tell them to their face that whenever we've handed this to an advertising agency, it just really hasn't worked. So, you know, our interagency team, sort of flexes, and you know, our comms team leads this initiative, but you need everybody on the bus. So, you know, everybody has a seat at the table because without the paid media team, without the advertising team, without the in-store, without e-com, this idea isn't going to grow to scale. So Tracy talked about scale. What's the advantage that we have, a big company and a big brand, over what some of these smaller brands have? We have deeper pockets. We can drive scale. So it's our we must raise the volume and really make an impact. So, you know, talking about like how do we then, you know, take it and translate it into the work? Like how do we then, like, you know, we got alignment, PR agency shepherding this through, all of this is happening. You know, how do we come up with the idea? So as much as I'd like to say, because I love brainstorming and consider myself a creative, you know, I'd like to sit there and say, you know, let's go to the races, we're going to start brainstorming right away, come up with an idea. Well, I also, there's another side that, you know, loves process. Sorry, I worked on P&G for a long time. And, you know, we need a process to get the end result of a very big idea, and that's what this chart is. It shows you that, you know, we kind of go through this Q&A with our own selves, and we pressure test, and we say, you know, what is the product that you produce, okay? And we go through, you know, are we producing a product that makes sense? Because again, you don't want to just come in and be like, we want to champion women. Well, why? What product are you making that makes sense there? And then are we doing good for the planet? Like, again, I really feel like it's an obligation for companies, you know, that have the spend that we have to really do good for the planet as well, for the people and the planet. And then speaking of the people, in today's world, you know, yes, we're socially listening, but you don't really have to listen too closely because people are just saying things. Like, I go on social media and I'm like, another person talking about going to the bathroom, another person like, and I'm like, really? Like, did I talk about this stuff? and it is very, everyone's open and honest, which is awesome. And that's the conversations we want to happen. And we are listening intently. We truly are, because without that information, we could steal the ideas from the consumers. They literally tell us what we want. So listening is so important as well. Oh my gosh, I have to race, go faster.
Talk about the
bear. And then progress. So let me just get into it, because I'm the type of person that I need to see how it works for a brand. Yep. So I can sit up here and I can say, oh, you know, this is go through these steps and do it. Let me show you. And I'm going to show you very quickly because we are running out of time, unless you want us to stay up here. So take a look at Bayer Aspirin. It, first of all, it's a very beloved brand. It literally saves people's lives. So if you take aspirin after having a cardiac event, you have about a 30% chance of not having another cardiac event. So like, who's not gonna gamble on that? And when we take a look at the planet, like Bayer is committed. We're committed to 100 million euros to sustainable packaging. And we do a lot of other things, but I'm using this as an example here. And then as far as people trust us. People love Bayer Aspirin, and they love Bayer. So, you know, we know that there's a compassion there that we can tap into. But when I look at progress, I'm like, Are we really making progress the way that we want to? Are we really tapping into communities that have high incidence of heart disease? So the Black community, high incidence of heart disease, and women as well. But we really wanted to tap into the Black community with the right kind of message that was authentic. And we owed it to ourselves to do that because we hadn't done it really before and leaned in. So we knew that was an opportunity for us. So we had to put an authentic voice forward without overdoing it. And the, I believe we get to an example here that I'm going to show you in the way that we did produce a campaign that aligned to our purpose, listening to the consumer and delivering the whole thing. So let's just get into the example.
Yeah, we wrote a song called Second Chance, celebrating Stuart's second chance.
So another powerful campaign, so we're obviously really truly leaning into purpose, and we don't really have to say much after you see something like that. Mm-hmm. You connect the dots yourself, and our brand purpose for aspirin is extending our, you know, patients' lives so they can spend more time with the people that they love. And that's really what that was all about. And I don't even have to tell you that. You can clearly see how it comes to life. And Leslie Odom Jr.'s story with his wife Nicolette just was so perfect. You would think, like, did we set that whole thing up? But no, it's, you know, where the connection was truly made and making sure that we did go through our steps and our process to come up with the right idea for these certain campaigns. So, yes, Tracy.
So I think, you know, we showed you three examples. We went through Midol, One A Day, and now Bayer Aspirin. And I think there are some really important commonalities across these campaigns that tie in what we talked about. I know one in particular being language and being sensitive to that and just very insights driven. So if you want to comment on that in particular.
Yeah, yeah. So while making sure our house is in order, right, you know, sweep your sheds before you start, you know, worrying about other people, you know, then we start to think about, like, how do we want to say what we say? And is there a pop culture theme we want to lean into? So, you know, when I talk about the language, it's really important to think about that. And we did think a lot about it when we came up with the Midol campaign. We purposely used menstruators. We wanted to be an inclusive brand. So, you know, we all know that menstruators come in all kinds of forms, and we wanted to make sure that we were reaching everybody. I will tell you, honest truth, did people come out, men and women, with negative thoughts towards that? Absolutely, but we built a community that you saw in the video that automatically rose up before I had a minute to, like, what are we gonna do with this crisis? It wasn't a crisis, but what are we gonna do about this? That community came out and spoke for us. There was nothing we needed to do. And you know then that what you're doing, even not the folks in the video, It was our community of followers on social media. How powerful was that? We were all so excited when that happened. You know, and speaking of tapping into pop culture, you might look at gratitude and you might say, oh, people talk about gratitude all the time. But what brand was talking about gratitude? What brand was talking about whole body gratitude and how you do that for yourself and how you lean in and raise the volume again? We have scale, so we wanted to take this conversation and elevate it to the next level. And as you could see, with billions and billions of impressions, it absolutely worked. So, you know, that was part of what we did.
So,
we're out of time.
Just to focus,
so hard stop.
We think it's important to start now, and now is the time to really start thinking about this and putting it into action. We know that 67% of consumers have higher expectations of brands than they used to. And we talked about, you know, even post-pandemic, a lot of those brands that came to our rescue, from Pfizer to Ford to Disney, et cetera, you know, saw a big elevation in public perception. And this really opened the door for consumers to think about brands in a more positive way. So I think the time is now to start, you know, saying big doesn't have to be bad. And we can take these approaches to prove them wrong and show how we can do this right and really regain that share for heritage brands. So thank you so much for your time.
And what I want to say is, like, don't give up on yourselves, okay? I spent 90% of my career at an agency. Be the fighters. Be the voice that champions for your clients. Whether you have somebody that's internally championing for you, make sure you're there and getting a seat at the table and having these conversations. It's absolutely possible. Bayer was a very traditional company, came in, and I can't believe the progress, along with 12 Note, have truly made. So I want everybody to walk out, and if not anything else, just say to yourself, well, wow, I feel really inspired that I can make a difference for my clients or for the companies that I work at to really, you know, develop work that's not only gonna win awards, but is really gonna move the needle for the company and the business. So, you know, thank you very much, as Tracy said, and it was a real pleasure to be here. So thank you for your attention.